A few months ago, we did an episode on why it's almost impossible for a car to go 1,000 miles per hour. Now, I'm not gonna spoil it for you, it's a good episode, but it turns out that top speed of a car isn't limited by physics, but rather by Mother Nature. So I started to think about the limitations of engine speed, and as it turns out, the fastest revving motor peaks at about 20,000 RPM. So, why is that? Well, today we're gonna figure out what limits engine speed, how engines can be built to spin faster, and why it's so hard to hit that 20,000 RPM ceiling. And if you don't care about any of those answers, don't worry. I'm gonna also light some fuel on fire. Let's go.
A big thanks to Keeps for sponsoring today's video. You know, I wanted to make 2021 about bettering myself. So I started working out, even joined the dating app. My nephew Nolan thinks I'm having some sort of midlife crisis. So I decided to go to therapy. And to be honest, I really think it's working out great. Then she ran out of the restaurant and out of my heart forever. Well, Doc, it all started when I became one out of 2 to 3 guys to experience some form of male pattern baldness by the time I was 35. No, but thinking back on it now, I probably should have. I mean, I should have started using Keeps. Okay, they make it easy by having your hair loss consultations online with real doctors. And then they ship your hair loss medication directly to your door every 3 months so you don't have to worry about going outside. Absolutely, okay? When they're ready to take action and prevent hair loss, all they gotta do is go to keeps.com/B2B or click the link in the description below and they'll get 50% off their first order. Spring break, eh? Yeah, I could do that. Imagine me in a bikini.
So Jerry Berry, what's so great about a high revving motor? Well, other than the sound and the bragging rights, it's all about horsepower. Horsepower is torque times revolutions per minute, which means that while an engine is producing torque, the faster it spins, the more horsepower it makes. But all motors have some limit to how fast they can spin, typically because of friction, heat, and wear. These problems affect everything from jet turbines to electric motors, but some of those can exceed 1 million RPM. So why do piston engines struggle to reach 20,000 RPM? Well, there are three main problems.
Uno, dos, tres. Boom, boom, boom.
Now, whether it's a Camry or a Mercedes W10 F1 car, all four-stroke engines turn fuel into horsepower using the same four steps. Suck, squeeze, ew, bang, blow. Each step begins with the piston at a dead stop, at top dead center or at bottom dead center. The piston accelerates from zero to its top speed, as much as 95 miles per hour, or 42.8 meters per second. And then it decelerates back to zero so it can change direction in the next step. This produces the first limiting factor for how fast an engine can spin. It's reciprocating masses we need to overcome. The moving object has an effective weight equal to its mass times any g-force exerted on it. But a piston only weighs what, maybe 500 grams? How bad could that be? Well, take the Cosworth V8 Formula 1 engine, for example. That's one of the few engines to ever hit 20,000 RPM. At that speed, the piston is accelerating, decelerating, and reversing over 600 times a second and producing 9,500 Gs. That gives a 500 gram piston an effective weight of 1,000 pounds. But it's not just the piston that has to withstand those G-forces. Oh no, it's the wrist pins, it's connecting rods, it's the crankshaft, the bearings, they all gotta keep that rapid acceleration and deceleration of the piston in check. So one reason why reciprocating engines have a limit to how fast they can spin is because beyond a certain speed, the effective weight of a piston will break ordinary bottom end parts. But we can solve this problem of reciprocating mass, and that's by beefing things up. You can strengthen the bottom end to deal with the additional weight that comes with higher engine speeds, using forged parts instead of casts, for example. But stronger often means heavier, and bottom end parts are also reciprocating or rotating, so you generally have to deal with the trade-off between strength and lightweight. You can switch to materials that are stronger and lighter, but that's gonna be more expensive. The limits of bottom end parts aren't the only reasons engines have rev limits. The top end is vulnerable too, and the second problem that high revs create is valve flow. An engine valve is pushed open when the camshaft or rockers press down on the valve shaft, pushing it into the cylinder. Once the cam lobe or rocker is no longer applying pressure, the valve is closed by a spring. So a valve is also a reciprocating mass. It travels in one direction, stops, then reverses, which takes time. In an overhead cam motor like the S2000, that's it. But in the case of a pushrod motor like a Chevy small block, the tappets, pushrods, and rockers, they are also reciprocating. The valve shaft is supposed to remain in contact with the cam lobe or lifter even when closed. But springs, they take time to expand. If the camshaft is moving too quickly because the engine is spinning too fast, it remains open for too long, protruding into the cylinder when it shouldn't be, or even rapidly opening and closing as the undamped valve spring oscillates. Just sits there, just in a constant state, looking compressed. The same thing happens in a pushrod motor, except now all the other parts between the valve and the cam can end up floating too. Now, when a valve floats, the best case scenario is the valve remains open a bit too long, reducing efficiency because the cylinder doesn't seal properly for the compression stroke. But many engines have an interference design where the valves and the pistons occupy the same space, just at different times. Well, you can probably see where the problem is. If an interference engine is spinning too fast and a valve stays open for too long, the piston could hit that valve. It's called freaking crap day. It's your crappy day. Okay, it crushes the valve and you got a ton of repair work to do. So how do you make valves that can cope with increased engine speed and avoid float? Well, you can use stiffer springs so that the valves snap shut faster. Of course, that means more force is required to open those valves as they open more slowly. The solution in some racing engines is to switch to a pneumatic spring. A nitrogen-filled piston retracts the valve more quickly and doesn't oscillate like a mechanical spring. The downside? Well, that's a much more complex and expensive system than the traditional overhead valve design or overhead cam designs. There's also some electronic valves, which is pretty interesting, or Koenigsegg's, they have their free valve technology. Again, very cool, but very expensive. So you might have noticed a trend so far. The factors that limit engine speed all can relate to carefully timed movements of its parts. But it's not just the movement of engine parts that have to be carefully timed. The third problem for revving high is that combustion itself takes time. Combustion starts at an ignition point, the spark plug in an engine, and moves outward into a process called flame propagation. The moving line of combustion is the flame front, and how fast it moves is the flame speed. You can see the flame propagate downward from the ignition point at the top of this bottle. That's like the flame front inside an engine cylinder is moving down from the spark plug. Every type of fuel has an intrinsic burning velocity, its flame speed under a set of ideal conditions. So we have two fuels that we tested. We used a standard ethanol-based fuel.
Super cash.
And we also used isopropyl alcohol, 91% isopropyl alcohol. Pretty potent stuff. You're not gonna find this high quality isopropyl alcohol at your local CVS. Actually, yeah, we did. We bought it at CVS, so. If we compare the speed of the flame propagation between these two, we can see that this fuel burns faster than this fuel. Different fuels, different burn rates. But burning velocity is just the beginning. Actual flame speed is affected by temperature, pressure, turbulence in the fuel, and the distribution of oxygen. When I used compressed air, I was creating turbulence, which slows flame speed. But I was also vaporizing the fuel, kind of like a fuel injector. So what does all this mean for rev limits? At 1500 RPM and at a 12:1 compression ratio, the flame speed in a gasoline engine is around 16.5 meters per second. But with changes in temperature, turbulence, and fuel air mixtures, flame speeds can vary between 10 and 80 meters per second. Piston speeds can reach 40 or 50 meters per second, meaning that under the right conditions at higher revs, the piston will outrun the flame propagation. If that happens, the combustion isn't exerting any force on the piston, and the engine simply can't spin any faster. It's sort of a built-in rev limiter that particularly affects engines that have a long stroke because of their higher piston speeds. In fact, one of the primary reasons why F1 engines can rev so high is because they have incredibly short stroke, just a bit over 53 millimeters. That's 2 inches. A short stroke keeps piston speeds low, prevents outrunning the flame front, and keeps effective masses manageable without heavy bottom end parts as you approach the 20,000 RPM ceiling. It also increases the space for valves, meaning you can feed more air into the cylinders. Large bore and small stroke is part of how Renault's 2006 F1 engines were capable of revving to a record 20,500 RPM. But there's always a couple downsides, and one of them is, with a short stroke, your very little power is made at lower RPM. That's why an F1 engine has to idle at 5,000 RPM just to stay running, and one reason why we don't have 20,000 RPM engines in our road cars. So now we know that if we want to rev high, we've got three problems to overcome. Damage to the bottom end from rapid acceleration and deceleration of the piston. We got damage to the top end from valves that aren't retracting quickly enough. And we got pistons that outrun combustion. The reason why every car doesn't redline at 20,000 RPM is because the solutions to these problems all come with trade-offs. You're a trade-off, okay? Your parents traded off having a fun life for... Thank you guys so much for watching this episode of B2B. We're getting up towards 5 million subscribers. Thank you guys so much for being part of the Donut family. We love you. Until next week, bye for now.